institution that is centered around human movement and closed chain kinematics. So all of our education keeps going back to the foot and the ankle and builds a very strong foundation that pretty much every activity that we do relies on that posture and function and integrated unit of the foot and ankle complex. So whether you have a client with low back pain or tonight's topic, shoulder dysfunction, you really have to start looking at the foot and the ankle and then integrate a lot of that foot fitness, barefoot training programming into shoulder rehab or low back pains and shoulder dysfunction. So tonight's webinar is on kinetic chain conditioning as it relates to the upper extremity. We are very excited to welcome Mat Boule, who is new to the EBFA faculty. Welcome, Mat.
Good evening, Dr. Emily. How are you?
I'm doing great. So Mat, if you're unfamiliar with who he is from Montreal, Canada. He is an osteopath and a posturologist. So he works during the day as a clinician, seeing a lot of patients with movement and postural dysfunction, suffering chronic pain. And then he uses a lot of his posturology and osteopath techniques to then assess and prescribe corrective exercise and exercise prescription. Mat is also a certified ART specialist and an MAT specialist as well. So without further ado, we're going to pass it on to Mat, and he's going to take us through a little teaser of our newest course at EBFA, which is Kinetic Chain Conditioning. It's all yours, Mat.
Thank you, Dr. Emily. So tonight's topic is entitled Kinetic Chain Conditioning, as we're going to look specifically at the links between the feet, as Dr. Emily mentioned. The feet is our base of support. It is probably the most important sensory receptor in our body that allows us to function. And obviously it links with the rest of the body, and tonight's talk is going to focus on the link between the foot and the shoulder. Next slide. And so here are the concepts that look at the and it's phase especially to look at how we condition these kinetic chains as we focus on as it relates to the shoulder. We're also going to evaluate today two specific chains. Know that there are many other chains that we look at in this specific shoulder course that we offer with EBFA. We're going to take a look at two of them today, and we're going to link how the foot affects the shoulder. Lastly, we're going to look at specific exercises that we can get from the shoulder, considering that something is in a dysfunctional state because of things that do not move or stand properly. And so let's look at kinetic chain. Well, if we can define it, the kinetic chain is the interrelation of the nervous, the muscular, and the skeletal systems towards producing a specific movement. And so it's a little bit more than just looking at how muscles work together. It's really how every system that contributes to movement actually works together. So there are different types of chains here. There's a specific picture here with Celine Dion from Montreal. You probably know that her first album to hit the English market was called Unison. And so I hope you get this joke. I think it's my only Canadian joke for the night, actually. The next slide. And so when we look at kinetic chain conditioning, then we're looking at exercise programming that takes into account these different factors, the nervous system, the muscular system, and the skeletal system. And so conditioning programs that incorporate kinetic chains, really looking at a biomechanical model, and we look specifically at creating relationships that are proximal to distal. And so that means two things. It can either be we look at stabilizing the core, the abdominal muscles, to make sure that we can move the limbs more effectively. Proximal to distal also means that we can have, we can look first and making sure that the foot is performing properly before any shoulder model. So kinetic chain conditioning, or KCC, focuses on movement patterns rather than isolated muscle exercises. And that's a key thing that you guys have to understand with kinetic chain conditioning. We're actually using the body the way it was meant to move. Isolation type exercises focus on, well, specific muscles, and specific muscles won't work together in real life. And so it's important to then sequence the activation of the foot, the trunk, and the muscles of the shoulder and the scapula in order to increase strength and stabilization. And that's exactly what kinetic chain conditioning is all about. And so let's take a look at evaluation here. If you look at the different sagittal planes that you see here, you'll see five different types of individuals. They actually represent just about 100% of what you'll find when you look at people posturally from a sagittal plane. Notice that most of us would want to be A, and A is a subject that stands with perfect curves, perfect lordosis of the neck and the lower back, and the scapula, the thorax, is perfectly aligned with the pelvis. And then if you look at B, C, D, and E, you'll see that something's basically wrong with every one of them. In the case of B, there's an increase in lordosis of the neck and the back, but yet the scapula and the pelvis are still aligned. In C, the scapula is posterior on the pelvis. In D, obviously the scapula is anterior to the pelvis. And in E, although the subject is perfectly aligned, there is, as you can see, a reduction in the curvatures of the low back and the neck. And so the two subjects that we're going to look at are specifically D and E, and how those postures contribute to shoulder dysfunction. Notice that A is about 10% of the population. The rest of us fit between B and E. So let's take a look at B, for example. Increased lordosis at the lower back and the neck. Well, if this postural dysfunction comes from the foot, what you will classically find is when you look at your client from the back and you evaluate their feet typically should present as valgus. Valgus means that the feet turn inwards, the arch of the feet tends to flatten, and it creates at the lower leg and at the thigh an internal rotation. And so these people are classically knocked knees. Now, it'll increase the curvatures of the low back and of the neck, if only because we still want to look in front of us. And so by keeping our eyes on the horizon, if our feet turn in, it increases the curvatures of our back and of our neck. So that's one type of dysfunction. And if we look at our next subject, our next subject is E. And E, well, has the exact opposite problem, right? He has a decrease of curvature in the neck and in the back. And he happens to present, if the feet are causing this imbalance, he happens to present with varus feet, which varus feet basically just means that the feet or the ankles really are turning outwards. And classically, it's associated with an external rotation of the hip and of the leg. So again, two types of dysfunctions of the feet that lead directly into the thorax and obviously into the shoulder. Next slide. We're going to take a more precise look at what we saw with the increase of lordosis because it's a much more common pattern. And so if you look at the pelvis and how it relates to the pelvis, a subject with valgus feet and an increase in lordosis will have a difficult time stabilizing the torso and the pelvis with their abdominals and their glutes. Because the possible finding that you're going to have is that the pelvis is in an anterior tilt, which will actually lengthen the resting tension of the abdominals and the glutes. And what's key about this is that if we're going to train by going from proximal to distal in this KCC concept, we have to realize that the muscles that are actually going to create the stabilization of the torso and of the pelvis are the glutes and the abdominals. They are the two strongest muscles of the core responsible for stability, and if our posture dictates that these muscles at rest are actually lengthened, it's going to be much harder to cue a client or yourself in terms of having the proper posture to do exercises properly, and those obviously include shoulder exercises. So it's something to take into consideration, and it's a concept that we evaluate in great details in the shoulder course offered by EBFA. Next slide. And so if we look at evaluation, the first thing we want to look at, because these muscular chains really start from the foot, is we want to evaluate their rear foot. Now, if you're a personal trainer, you work with clients, or if you want to look at a friend of yours, basically you stand behind them, and ideally your eyes are at their feet level. So you pretty much have to bend on your knees and look at their rear foot. And initially, you want to see if that rear foot is standing neutral, if it's externally rotated or internally rotated. So we call it that when the ankle goes inwards, we call this a valgus foot, and when the ankle presents outwards, we call it a varus foot. Now that's when you look at them standing on both feet. What we can also do, and I actually prefer that test because it tells me how that foot moves, is that in the case of the picture you're seeing right now, you keep the left foot on the ground and you bring the right one up, which allows you to see how that left foot then stabilizes. Now, if it pivots mostly inwards, it is called a valgus, and it is not normal that it would pivot inwards. It's actually supposed to stay just about in the center with a very small amount of pivoting outwards. And in that case, the foot actually creates an arch that allows you to be stable as the foot creates stability through an arch. And so this is what you want to look at when you evaluate the rear foot. And you obviously want to do both. So you want to see if you have, for example, maybe 2 feet that go into valgus, 2 feet that go into varus, which would lead to the postures we saw. Now, what we're not going to look at tonight, but again, we evaluate this quite thoroughly in the shoulder course, is that you could have 1 foot that goes valgus and one that goes varus. And what that would create in terms of posture are tilts and rotations at the pelvis and the shoulders, typically affecting the spine and, well, just about every joint, including the shoulder. So foot evaluation is really important. And what we're showing you here today is a brief summary of what we can do. Next slide. And so then it's also important to actually evaluate the shoulder. Before you start giving your clients actual shoulder exercises, we need to see if the shoulder has good motion. And so here you see my assistant. She is sitting on the treatment table. You get to see the nice view I have as well outside of my office. The client is standing, or in this case, seated. Now, ideally, and again, we just didn't take the right picture, but ideally, you'd have the person stand against the wall with a posterior pelvic tilt. And what that would do is that it would basically make sure that when the person goes into shoulder flexion, and this is the movement we're testing, that they're not actually using their back. But here, I cued my client to actually keep their back straight and to exclusively move the arm into flexion. And I obviously compared both sides to see if there was an imbalance. In this case, I still got a very good reading because she wasn't actually compensating with her back to do this test. Next slide. And so when we look at exercise prescription for the shoulder and we take into consideration the evaluation that we've done when we were looking at the foot and then we looked at the shoulder motion, well, the goal of doing both really was to see if there was an association so that we can start understanding maybe why we would potentially even have a shoulder flexion deficit, which is classically tested for shoulder problems, where EBFA is taking this a step further, is that we're actually looking at the reason why that shoulder might be limited in movement, and it often comes from the foot. I would say I see an average of 7 to 10 cases a day. I cannot say that it happens very often, that shoulder restriction is not at least caused in part by feet that are not properly. Whether you treat or if you treat. And so you'll typically find a decrease of shoulder flexion with individuals that present with an increased pelvic tilt as you tested them with a posterior pelvic tilt when you did the shoulder evaluation. Yet, important to realize is that when you want to mobilize the shoulder, you have to stabilize the thorax. And just know that for these people, you're going to have to cue them a little bit more intensively because of that link, that the spine that they have. And so in order to stabilize the thorax, the spine, and the pelvis, there are three cues that are necessary. Number one, you want to create an internal rotation of the hip. That basically means when they're standing and they're doing exercises for the shoulder, you want them to actively turn their feet inwards facing each other. Now, it's uncommon, and it's maybe the first time you've heard this, but the idea is that if the feet are turning in, the hips are turning in as well, and while rotation in your rotation is actually in position to complete the hip. And so if you're in a complete, a stable pelvis, a stable core, to increase mobility of the shoulder, well, you have to do everything you can to create a stable core, and one of those things is an internal hip rotation, so the movement of the femur inwards on the acetabulum. The second component is knees locked. We, as human beings, are very lucky to have this tissue called the IT band. People see it as always dysfunctional. I have it, it's connected with tissues in the body because it goes from the lumbar fascia, stabilizes your back, your shoulder, and your glutes, and it actually merges into the IT band, which goes all the way down to your knee. So what we're looking at is that when you lock your knees and your feet are turned in, you're actually creating stability all the way down to the knee, creating stability really from the foot up so that you can mobilize the shoulder properly. And the third component is the posterior pelvic tilt. Now, it's extremely important to tilt the pelvis posterior. Number one, it actually decompresses the lumbar spine, which we all want to do in the exercise. Number two, the muscles we use to do this are the glutes and the abdominals. Anyone name me, and if you can post this as a question, or if you have any ideas about this, if anyone can give me two muscles that are better outside of the abs and the glutes at stabilizing the pelvis, they create a perfect posterior rotation, and those muscles you want to use to accomplish the third cue. So when you do exercise with clients, actually whether it be for the shoulder or even other body parts when it's appropriate, you want to look at having these components in. Next slide. So when you perform exercises, once you've got your basis of support that is stabilized, your feet that are turned in, your abs that are tight, you're actually ready now to mobilize the shoulder. You have to mobilize it with the available range of motion that you for that. If you have a limitation in lumbar flexion, you might not be able to describe a military press or a lat pull down. It really just depends on the range that you're being given by your client, and you have to respect that range, no matter how stable you make the body with the three cues we mentioned a few minutes ago. Next slide. And so here are two exercises for the shoulder when there is a limited range of motion. So at this point, you've evaluated the feet, you've evaluated their posture, you've basically looked at their shoulder function, and you've been able to make links between what could be happening with their feet and what's happening with their upper body. And so I'm going to show you now two exercises that you can do with the flexion, considering all the dysfunctions that we've seen. So in the first exercise, what you'll see here is my assistant Kevin. And Kevin is going to be pushing with the right arm, and he's going to be pulling with the right arm, but notice that he's got a resistance going both ways. And so pushing with the right arm, and then pulling with that arm by using the opposite cable that he's transferring, actually works under the traction. If we look at the second one, this works between the glutes and the lats, the thoracolumbar fascia. Notice that Kevin is simultaneously creating tension. Muscles that stabilize fascia at the same time. And he's doing a great job there. Notice that we've got external rotation of both hips for especially to target the glutes, which are ankle-rolled. One more rep, Kevin. You can do it. Awesome. Very good. And so that's our talk, guys. Take a look at this slide. First of all, if you have any questions, please post them as we're available to answer. And you can check out our upcoming workshops, the Barefoot Training Specialist Workshop, which takes a very, very precise look at barefoot training with a lot of science and a lot of life to it, offered in February in both California and New York. And kinetic chain conditioning, focusing on the shoulder, which is an extended version of what you've heard tonight, will be offered on March 16th in New York City. You can check our website out for more information. So at this point, I'm wondering if any of you have open questions.
Yeah, I encourage anyone who has questions for Mat Boule to post them. Can type in the questions and I'll read them to Matt. I do have a question for you, Matt, though.
Mm-hmm.
My own question is, how often do you get a patient who has this shoulder dysfunction? It's chronic. They've been trying to recover for it for quite some time, and they've gone from specialist to specialist, and then they eventually find their way to you. And how often do you then look at the foot and you realize that all along, kind of that driving force, or that initiating deformity or dysfunction was actually from the foot, and then once you corrected the foot, kind of the rest of the kinetic chain leading up to the shoulder was then able to be corrected?
I'd have to say it's almost 100% of the time where the foot is a component of the issues they have in the shoulder. And then it varies. Is it 50% of the issue? Is it 20? I've seen it even clear up in a few patients up to 70% of range of motion deficits when we actually work on the foot. And so, and it goes for the foot, but it actually goes for just about any joint. I give the analogy to my patients that if their house was built on a foundation that was off kilter, they could argue with trying to put the paintings straight on their walls. They would argue a long time, really with themselves trying to do this because their house is off kilter. It cannot be otherwise. When you look at it from a physics and engineering standpoint, it is impossible to think that the rest of your body can perform well when your feet are off level. And so for a shoulder, even though it is, we would look at it geographically and think, wow, the shoulder is actually located quite far from the feet. But the body is interlinked by joints and chains of muscles, which we specifically train with kinetic chain conditioning as we promote with EBFA. So what we're doing makes incredible sense, and to not look at the foot is basically, for me, missing the boat completely when it comes to shoulder or just about really any joint.
Right, exactly. I try and encourage that in the low back course that I teach, and I think that's kind of the mission of EBFA, is trying to get the fitness industry to get everybody's shoes off, look at the function of the foot, and go one step further than just kind of like a custom, okay, you're exercising barefoot, but how can we really, really use corrective exercise to correct the foot and have that be a central part of their shoulder rehab or their back rehab, and like you said, kind of reset their foundation and, build that strong foundation on their house, or, which is, our body for every movement that we do.
Yeah. Yeah, it's essential. I always actually start with the foot, and I mean, I'm not even trained as a podiatrist, but yet, when you look at this objectively and logically, I don't think you can start anywhere else, really. So the way we're training physical specialists, physical trainers to do things, I think makes perfect sense, and to start with the foot, to me, sounds like the best place to start, really.
Good. Well, thank you so much. We are very excited to have you as part of the faculty today. For everybody tuning in, if you're looking for upcoming workshops, well, now there's questions. Okay. All right. Of course, as I'm trying to end. All right. So we have a question on how much influence would you say the lateral medial collateral ligaments have in causing the velvet foot? Well,
it's a good question. I mean, unless you've had actual trauma to your ligamentous system, the ligament wouldn't be the first place to look at. More precisely, by the time you're looking at the knee, for me, the knee is already often very adaptive on the foot. What I mean by that is that the foot is really the most deformable structure based on the fact that it's the terminal buffer of the chain, right? It's basically the link between your body and the ground. So if you have a dysfunction just about anywhere, whether it be in the feet or from other parts of your body will go into tilts and rotations and and postural strains. And at the end of the day, your foot will then start deviating. And basically, so then the foot becomes the primary place to intervene. So the role of the ligaments then, unless there was trauma, and then all you can really do is heal from that trauma and potentially do proprioception exercises for that precise area. But I'd say most of the cases I see are atraumatic. So my experience with dealing with a traumatic cause causing a valgus, I can't say I've seen that very often. Most of the people that I see suffer from postural imbalances that often don't have a trauma notion to them. So then that question of ligament, as far as I'm concerned, is just not it's not that relevant for most people.
Right. It's often related more to the dynamic support of the foot. So I guess to kind of mm-hmm. add on a little bit more to that for David, who asked the question, is in the foot and ankle courses that I teach, I go into a lot of the posterior tibialis, which is kind of your stirrup muscle on the inside of your ankle. So then that controls a lot of the supination action or force in your foot. And a foot that's valgus or overpronated, which is kind of the foot that Matt says is valgus, usually has kind of a weakness or dysfunction in the posterior tibialis, or it can be a compensation for decreased ankle joint range of motion, so tight calves.
Mm-hmm.
Your foot compensates by overpronating and trying to get over the metatarsal joint, because it cannot get over the ankle joint, so it gets over the metatarsal joint through overpronation. And we go into a lot of these in both, again, the foot and ankle course and the barefoot training specialist course. So, and I have a lot of articles on the blog about foot and ankle function, pronation, supination, things like that. So if anyone is curious to read more about that. All right, here's another question. Since many people have had pain for years, how long after you prescribe corrective exercise does it take for clients to improve their foot function?
I use a combination
of tools. You want, and then I'll...
Yeah, I use a combination of tools. Exercise is one. As Dr. Emily was saying, I'm an osteopath and a posturologist. I have to say that with using the posturology technique, it typically allows me to realign an individual just about in that session. When someone is functioning with an aligned system, which then the feet have to actually be aligned and work symmetrically, the pain level goes down fairly fast. Sometimes it's just about all gone in that one session, but then what needs to be done to maintain those gains, outside of corrective tools that I use within posturology, we have to then prescribe exercises to build motor patterns so that the system really feels comfortable with these corrections and with this new way of being and of doing. And so I would say it's necessary, as far as the work that I do, to really add an exercise component such as the one that Dr. Emily speaks of. And specifically when she mentions the role of the posterior tibialis in terms of creating supination, I see weaknesses there all the time with valgus feet. And so these muscles do have to be strengthened. What's your thought on it, Dr. Emily?
This is the one area that I do like orthotics, and don't throw anything from the computer at me, Matt. But when a patient or a client is in severe pain, then I actually do like orthotics, because you get the foot or the body out of kind of that painful posture. And then once all of the tissue starts calming down, then you can start doing a lot of the corrective exercise. So, you know, say somebody had like posterior tibial tendonitis, which would present to me as like a flat foot. So maybe one foot was flat and not the other one. Suddenly their arch dropped and they came to you. Like, you know, the problem is in the posterior tibialis, but I need to hold it acutely in the correct position, which is held through the orthotic. Once everything calms down, then I like to take away the orthotic and start building the natural structure and support back in the foot. Any corrective exercise for the foot, you want to kind of compare to like the rest of the body, you know, it takes about 6 weeks for any adaptation to take through the muscle and body tissue. So, you know, it's not like a couple weeks and then their foot is like reversible. And then I go into this a lot in my classes as well, is that certain foot types and dysfunctions and imbalances just cannot be corrected through corrective exercise. So your role is to know which feet you can actually correct, or how can you at least minimize the pain or control and kind of keep them in this like neutral position as much as you can through corrective exercise. So, you know, arthrodes and, you know, DJD and rigid foot types and stenosis in the lumbar, like a lot of these, I guess, pathologies, they're structural now. So you can't completely reverse them, but you can at least help the client be comfortable and at least, you know, be able to do activities of daily living. So I hope that helps answer Lindsay's question. I don't know if Matt wanted to ask any or add anything else, or you're...
No, that was really complete. I'm just happy you said at the end that you tried to take away the orthotics. That made me very happy, I have to say.
So, yes, Lindsay, to add on, she says, so if you use the orthotic to get through the pain, yes, absolutely. Then I do corrective exercise. If the client stays in the orthotic without corrective exercise, the foot will become weak. And there is a lot of research that when you are in the orthotic, that you do start to get a decrease of muscle activation in those muscles, because it's not the muscle that's supporting the foot, it is then the orthotic. And then unless that client is wearing that orthotic and their shoes, from the second they get up from the bed to the second they go to bed at night, you know, that's like a commitment when, you know, as you're moving around your house and you're comfortable, you want to be able to have that support in your foot itself. And that is kind of following this whole concept of corrective exercise. And you would probably agree, Matt, that it's much more functional to try and, you know, build the strength within the foot itself.
Yeah, the analogy I always give, and I think people will appreciate this, is that if you have a fracture on your elbow and you need a cast, logically we need to cast so that the fracture can heal. But let's say as a doc, you go on vacation and you forget about your patient, and let's say you've gone on vacation for about 4 years. The muscles atrophied to the point where all you pull is the joint completely stiffened up, and basically there's no more fracture, but there's no elbow. And so then I think about this and I'm thinking, well, are the joints in the ankle and feet any different from the ones in the elbow? You know, there's a lot of similarities. And then you think, okay, well, if we put an orthotic in there and we leave it there for 4 years, which is what a lot of patients are actually prescribed on a daily basis, and more so in America than in Europe, the trends are definitely starting to change in terms of how aggressive we are. Devices. And so honestly, if you leave orthotics in feet for very long, and you say to research and that goes in the same direction, basically the muscles atrophy. There's also the role of the skin. Now, the skin of the foot is extremely rich in mechanoreceptors, which are basically receptor feet that tell your brain where you're at on the ground. And what research has shown is that when these receptors are stretched, and some of them are sensitive to 1/100 millimeter of pull. That's basically a hair is really thick compared to that. And so an orthotic, it's been shown, stretches the skin to the point where these receptors are stretched and they actually become less efficient at telling the brain where you're at. So orthotics create two problems long term. One is that they create an atrophy of the muscles, which is bad enough in itself because then your foot can't support itself. But actually even worse as far as what I've seen is that if the skin of your feet isn't telling your brain where you're at on the ground anymore, your feet are becoming, in terms of sensory input, blind, and it's your entire body that stiffens up over time so that you can actually stand on both of your feet in normal circumstances. And so I can't see how, under any circumstance, you would want to wear orthotics for a long period of time. And obviously the idea and the ideal situation is that we can do without and that we can rehabilitate feet to work by getting the feet themselves to work, which makes so much sense.
So, good. Good answer, Matt. Glad we're in agreement. So thank you guys so much for your questions. Thank you for tuning in. Eric Grant, thank you for the comment. He just agreed and it's kind of, you know, kind of on the same page as where we are, and everything does start in the foot. So thank you for tuning in and your comment. If you guys have any, you know, last questions, if you're not following us on Facebook, follow us. And post your questions, your comments, and if you want to tune in or share this, it will be posted on the EBFA website, you know, by the end of the week. So thank you all, and we will see you hopefully in March for that webinar where I will be speaking about trigger points and the role that trigger points have in limiting ankle joint mobility. So it's called Beyond Stretching. And this is a big part of my foot courses as well, is that there's certain foot types and certain muscles that you really should be doing trigger point release and not stretching. So it's very exciting. We'll explore that, and I hope to see you all then. Have a great night. Night, Matt.
Have a good night.